So we're looking at the results of the carbon-14 dating demonstrated serious problems for long geologic ages. So we're looking at carbon-14 dating and the problems that it brings about when you try and fit it with billions of years. It doesn't fit. So it doesn't, the evidence that's actual there, the facts don't match the teaching that they give to us. And it's interesting as we get into this here. It says samples were taken from 10 different coal layers that, according to evolutionists, represent different time periods in the geologic column. The coal samples, which date to hundreds of millions of years based on standard evolution time estimates, all contained measurable amounts of C14. Okay, now the next section tells us why that's wrong. Because carbon-14, its half-life, at best, it'll only be 100,000 years. It'll only be detectable at 100,000 years. Okay, it's weird the way it breaks down at half its life, half of it's gone, and then another 5,730 years is the half-life, the next half is gone, and so on and so forth, till by the time you get to 100,000 years, you no longer are going to have any traceable amounts of carbon-14. So if there's carbon-14 present in something they're testing, what does that tell you? That's right. It's not a million years old, and at best, it's 100,000 years old. At best. So it's got to be less than 100,000 years old if you're measuring any carbon in it. So if it's a million years old or anything like that, there should be zero carbon-14 left in it. All right, this has been confirmed by the best carbon-14 dating laboratories. So, I mean, outside labs testing this stuff, it's not, you know, them trying to push some agenda. And it's taken from this right here, Radioisotopes and the Age of the Earth. That was a big study. It's called the Rate Study. There's two books on it. All right, Dr. Andrew Snelling, the best laboratories in the world using the best equipment under the cleanest conditions over the last three decades have been routinely finding measurable radiocarbon in coal, oil, natural gas, limestone, fossil bones, fossil shells, and even diamonds. And those things are all said to be millions, if not hundreds of millions of years old. Well, how can that be when the evidence tells us that can't be true? Because based on the science that we know that is provable, you know, demonstrable, testable, repeatable, all that stuff, it says that can't be, because if there is any carbon-14, then it has to be 100,000 years or younger. So their preconceived ideas that they come to the table with are false. They're starting off with a false premise, believing that it's hundreds of millions of years old when the evidence proves otherwise. If these were all millions of years old, then there should be no radiocarbon left in them. The fact is that all these materials yield radiocarbon dates of only thousands of years. So they fit with what we actually know. They only yield dates of thousands of years. All of this is documented in scientific literature, such as in the journal Radiocarbon. So there's a great amount of evidence that the Bible is right after all about the Earth's age. Well, amen. That's what we take it as. All right, number three. Evolutionary dating methods give widely different results. This is where we left off and we're picking up here. The rest was review. I just wanted to remind us where we were at. So these dating methods give widely different results. This is known as the anomaly factor. Scientists have tried to eliminate it, but they have been unsuccessful. So the anomaly factor is the idea that they give all these crazy dates from one end of the spectrum to the other. How come they don't all fit, okay? Rock paintings. This is good right here. You're going to like this. I mean, don't those look... I mean, those got to be old, right? Look at them. Rock paintings in the South African bush in 1991 were dated by Oxford University's radiocarbon accelerator at 1,200 years. 1,200 years old. But they had actually been painted by an art class only a few years earlier. Oh, ouch, huh? Boy. oh, man. Scratch your head on that one. What do we do about that, right? Man, but this is the junk science they use, too. Teach evolution and whatnot. These are their dating methods. Volcanic rocks in Hawaii were dated at 160 million to 3 billion years old when they were actually formed from an eruption in 1801. Well, there goes that idea, huh? Rocks at the Mount Ngauruhoe volcano in New Zealand were dated at 270,000 to 3.5 million years old. But that's quite a range right there, 270 to... So a quarter million years to 3.5 million years. I mean, that's a difference of 3.25 million years old. Million years difference. But they were actually formed between 1949 and 1976. Man, stubborn facts, right? Who was it that said, You know, only problem with facts is they get in the way of what you're trying to teach. Something like that, I butchered that, but I mean, that's what happens. Facts just tend to get in the way of what you're trying to teach. Observe that the dates provided by radiometric dating differed by 3 million years. That's crazy. I mean, this is the anomaly factor. So here's what happens. That's not going in a science book right there. I can tell you that much right now. All right, Louis Leakey's Zinjanthropus skull was dated at 1.75 million years by the potassium-argon method. Here we go, and at 10,000 years by the carbon-14 method. So if carbon-14's in it, you know that it cannot be more than 100,000 years old. But which one do you think they're going to use? And these scientists know that. But which method how do you think they're going to date it? How old do you think they're going to tell people it is? They're going with that one right there, 1.75 million years. You know that's what they're going to go with. Just throw out the stuff we don't like. Look, as Bible believers, we can't do that. We can't throw out the stuff that that doesn't fit in our mind, and we can't make it fit our theology. We can't do that. We have to rethink our theology then and rethink some of the things we've been taught, because we want to be true to the Word of God. But these so-called scientists, they don't have integrity to do this stuff. I mean, we looked at Haeckel's drawings and stuff. He had no integrity to change them and alter them how he wanted and push that off as science. That's what happened. That's why we've all followed those Haeckel's charts and all that nonsense that was proven false, yet they're still put out there even to this day. We know it's false, and it's still put out there in science books like it's truth. A layer of volcanic ash at Lake Turkana, Kenya, was dated by three different teams, with results varying from 500,000 to 17.5 million years. So it's not like they had some agenda to try and, you know, let's put our data together. Three different teams, all the way from 500,000 years to 17.5 million years. That's only 17 million years difference, right? That's why you look at what they push and, oh, everything keeps getting older and older. The Earth's older and older, and it's just, oh, it's as many billions of years old, and we can't say. So, hey, if it's billions, I mean, what's 17 million? I mean, it's not that big a deal, is it? Dr. Steve Austin, a member of the RATE Project, had samples tested from the alleged oldest and youngest strata of the Grand Canyon. All right, so based on, you know, the geologic column, right? You can see it right here. Okay, there's the geologic column. All right, so the oldest is going to be on the bottom, right? Because that was laid down first. Youngest is going to be on the top somewhere. Okay, so he had samples taken from the oldest and the youngest. All right, here's what they found. He used the isochron dating method, which is supposed to be infallible. So this is like as good as it gets, apparently. All right, the oldest rocks were dated at 1.07 billion years, while the youngest were dated at 1.34 billion. What? Come on, help us now. And this is the science that we're supposed to follow? I'm telling you, you're going to get in a debate with people about this stuff, and they're going to be like, science has proven evolution with this junk? I mean, this is what we're following? I'm just so you know, I just want you to know this is what they fall back on. Thus, the infallible isochron dating method says that the youngest strata is 270 million years older than the oldest strata. It's not like it's off by like 10,000 years. 270 million years older than the oldest strata. Man. In another RATE study, rocks from the Beartooth Mountains in Wyoming range from 1.5 to 2.6 billion years. That is a difference of more than a billion years. I mean, come on, a billion years? But this is the best stuff. Dating methods that are this wildly variable and contradictory surely lack real scientific authority. That should just be like, ding, 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 ding. You know, I mean, that's like me saying, hey, I passed my test with a 10%. What? I wish in school, right? Kids, any of you want to say you passed your test with a 10%? Like, I'll take that, right? It doesn't work like that, right? There's a big difference between 100 and a 10%, and that's only 90. All right, not these variables that they have. So evolutionists are highly selective in choosing dates. Let's go ahead and open our Bibles real quick. I may be wrong on this. Go to, I'm going to have to look for it. 1 Peter, 2 Peter is what we're looking for. Second Peter chapter 3. All right, Second Peter chapter 3, verse 4, and saying, Where is the promise of his coming? Now, let's back up. Let's go up higher. Let's just start in verse 1. 2 Peter 3:1. The second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, so get this, that there shall come in the last days, okay, you look at Hebrews chapter 1, we're in the last days, okay, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts. Okay, they're scoffing, they're mocking the Bible, they're laughing at it. It's a joke to them. Why? Because they want to walk after their own lusts. Verse 4, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? So they mock that. Oh, Jesus isn't coming back again. God's not coming back again. For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. So everything's the same, that uniformitarianism, okay? We talked about that. But it says, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. Verse 5, for this they willingly are ignorant of. Willingly are ignorant of. I like what Kent Hovind said about that. I mean, dumb on purpose. They willingly are ignorant. I don't want to know. They see the facts. I don't want to know. Don't tell me. Okay? They're willingly ignorant of that by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water perished. So they're willingly ignorant of the fact that by the word of God, the heavens were of old. They reject that. They will not accept it. Why? Because they're walking after their own lusts. So they're willingly ignorant of it. So things this blatantly obvious that we've been looking at, how can anybody believe that? How can anybody follow that as their life's philosophy? How can they do that? Because they're willingly ignorant. Because they do not want to bow their knee to God. That's what it comes down to. They want to walk after their own lusts. That's what it is. All right, evolutionists are highly selective in choosing dates. Typically, they select dates they prefer while ignoring those they find unacceptable. Dating methods for a young Earth are ignored. Science has proposed many methods of geochronometry, but of these, only one, that of the radioactive decay of uranium and similar elements, yields an age for the Earth of billions of years. This is the one method that has been enthusiastically promoted, while all the other methods have been neglected. So if this is the case, wouldn't you say that we can't really rely on any of this? I mean, to me, when they vary so much, you can test the same type of thing. I'd say that we can't rely on much of any of these dating methods. To me, when they're giving you such varying differences, why are they doing that? And I'm not a scientist to get into all of that, but I can read and at least look at facts and say something ought to give here. Let's stop trusting in this stuff. But hey, the Bible says the Jews seek after a sign, the Greeks seek after knowledge. All right, and our society is enamored with knowledge. I can't, just be careful. There's nothing wrong with learning and knowing things. But we want knowledge, biblical knowledge, tempered with wisdom, godly wisdom. Okay, because our society is infatuated with knowledge. But here you've got a generation of people that have been brought up, maybe a generation or two, that you know you have to go to college, 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 have to go to college. You're a loser if you don't go to college. You're a nothing if you don't go to college. And you have to get this degree. And now we've got, you know, this generation that had to go to college, had to go to college, and now none of them can get jobs. None of them have jobs. They have no practical experience. They don't know how to do anything but whine and cry because they didn't get their way. I'm telling you, but all this protesting about the elections about, some of it's staged and paid for, but a lot of the whining about it, hey, I didn't want Trump. I didn't like him. I didn't want Hillary either. But look, I'm not whining about it. I mean, when Obama got in 2008 and 2016, or 2012, I wasn't happy about that either. I didn't want that either, but I didn't whine and throw a fit and go protest. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with protesting if you do it the right way. I'm all for protesting. Amen. I think we should have the right to do that. But going and destroying people's property, man, I can go off on this. This is what happens when everybody gets a trophy. I'm telling you, a participation trophy, you're all winners. No, you're not. Some of you are going to be losers. And they can't handle it. They can't deal with it. I don't like losing. You guys know that I don't like losing. But man, that's part of life. You're not going to get everything the way you want. And we're raising them on this and teaching them that you're always going to get what you want. So now this stuff comes up and they don't know what to do with it. All right. So this is one of the methods that's been enthusiastically promoted while all other methods have been neglected. So just we should just do away with it if it doesn't work. There are powerful professional pressures on scientists to conform to a consensus. The published dating figures always conform to preconceived dates and never contradict those dates. I mean, just think about it. Go to your own workplace, and when you start pointing out things, maybe that they've always done it this way, and you're seeing there's things wrong with this, if any of you have ever done that in a workplace, you're not going to be liked by too many people once you start doing that. And I'm not talking about going in there and being contrary just to be contrary and cause problems. I'm talking about you're trying to help things along, maybe make it better, but you start changing things and people get all upset about it. We've always done it this way. There's a pressure to just fit in, just conform. That's always on us. The Bible tells us, be not conformed to this world. Don't be like this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That's what the Bible tells us we should do and we should strive for, is to being conformed to the image of Christ, not conformed to this world. It'd be like being put in a mold. I mean, if you're going to, you know, they have those jello molds that you could, or even a cake or whatever, and you pour it in that mold and it falls in place and fits. So once you take it off or you undo it, then, you know, you flop it over and it's made that shape and it looks like that. And this is what the pressure that's put on Christianity and on Christians, just conform. Just shut your mouth, conform, go along with it. Don't say anything against it. Why are you so hateful? Why are you so judgmental? Look, just line up with the Bible and let them call you what they're going to call you, because it's coming anyway. But that's what's going on right here with these dating methods. They're saying, just conform. Throw out the dating methods or the dates that don't fit with what we're trying to teach here. That's where you have to come down to the integrity of the individual and the character within them to stand against all that and risk losing their job. I mean, are you going to stand for truth when it costs you losing your job? I mean, we can all stand here and say, yes, I would, until you're about to lose your job. That's not an easy decision to make, I guarantee it. I mean, hey, I hope we would, right? But when you're in that place and you're like, well, what am I going to do about my mortgage? What am I going to do about my car payment? How am I going to feed my family? How am I going to do this? What will I do? I can't lose my job. So see, real life steps in and people are going to say, well, you know, these other dating methods, they did. This is what they said. I'm not changing what they said, but these ones don't agree with it. So, well, I'll just leave these ones out. Conform. Conform. And that's what happens. Hey, Christians face that stuff all the time too. I mean, hey, sensitivity training. You know, people have lost their jobs because they're getting, you know, propaganda coming from the human resources department telling them they have to accept diversity. And, you know, diversity now means the sodomite lifestyle is what you have to accept. And you have to be okay with that, and transvestites and everything else. And, you know, if she wants to be called a he, you got to call her a he. And all this nonsense. And people have stood their ground and said, I'm not going to do that. I mean, I remember reading about one guy, and I don't have the facts in front of me, but he just simply responded back a mass email to all employees of this company. He just responded back to human resources. He said, just don't send me these emails anymore telling me about all this. I don't want that. Lost his job for it. Pushing this sensitivity. You know, and Christians are going to have to decide, am I going to stand my ground and lose my job? Because that's what's going to happen. You might get it back. You probably won't. But am I going to stand my ground and stand on my principles and lose my job or conform? See, when it gets real life to us, we can look at these scientists and say, oh, how dare they? How come they don't just stand with the facts and stand with the truth? How dare us? How come we don't just stand with the facts and stand with the truth? Amen? Because it's just the same for us. So put yourself in their shoes, and this is what they're facing. I'm not saying it's right, but this is what they're facing. Plus, on top of that, they're probably lost. They're probably lost. And some of those lost men have been willing to lose their jobs when Christians aren't. Think about that one. What was it? A year and a half ago. I think it was the summer of 2015. We had that big ruckus. I forget the lady's name over in Kentucky, who the state's office, I can't remember her name, but she wouldn't sign marriage licenses. What's her name? Jill? Kim Davis. There we go. Kim Davis. She was willing to go to jail for that. Willing to go to jail for that. I know preachers that wouldn't do that over that issue. I know, we just want to preach the gospel. How about we stand and contend for the faith? It's not just the gospel. It's the contend for the faith once delivered to the saints. That's all of it. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto every good work. See, we have to decide what we're going to do when it comes down for us. It's easy to look at somebody else and say, how dare they? But let's figure out where we stand. What are we going to stand with? I mean, some of you kids, you're in public school or whatever, and you end up getting some assignment that you have to do on evolution. Man, I mean, there's ways around it where you can write it. Even if you're in college, you got to write a paper or something. You know, you're like, I don't agree with any of this. This is all garbage. Well, you can write a paper in such a way that, you know, you don't compromise your convictions. You can say, my teacher taught me that the earth is 65 billion years old, but here's, and throw out some evidence for it. And you might get an F on the paper, but amen, you might fail the class, but where do you stand? You know, I mean, we just have to think about real life when it comes to these things, all right? In general, dates in the correct ballpark, okay, are assumed to be correct and are published, but those in disagreement with other data are seldom published, nor are discrepancies fully explained. So we're just going to do away with this. We're not going to show the young people this. We're not going to show them these facts. We're not going to even allow them to see this. That's why they're pushing. Look, we could get into a big old thing here about public schools and all that, and should we even have public schools? I say no, okay, but I'm not here to argue that and to get into all that. But look, here's the thing in public schools. Some have tried to push for at least opening the teaching up and allowing the teaching of theistic evolution or creation and letting the students decide. Oh, you can't have, you know, no religion in the Bible. But what they believe is religion, because they read in the textbooks, it says, we believe that the earth was, you know, started, you know, however many billions of years ago. They're always changing it and adding more to it. But it's by faith. They believe it by faith, too. We believe. We think. They don't know. They have no idea. They could say, oh, we, you know, this happened, which is usually false and wrong anyway. But when you nail them down and say, well, where'd that come from? They're going to say, if you just keep pushing and keep pushing, we don't know. That's right. You don't know because you weren't there. But all the data, all the evidence agrees with this book, but they're willingly ignorant of. Why? So they can, as the Bible says right there, walk after their own lusts. That's why. So they can continue walking after their own lusts. So keep that religion out of schools. Let's not even give them another option. Don't teach them to think critically. I just received a survey in the mail from UNM, you know, political sciences, doing a survey on the election. So I said, I'll fill this out. I mean, that thing is so biased as I'm answering some of the questions. I even wrote in. I said, I don't even agree with none of these options you give me. But it's biased to, it's either this one or this one. And it's the whole, you know, just the paradigm of, you know, it's either Republican or Democrat. That's not all there is. So it's saying these are the only options. And a lot of the questions, it's saying, well, do you agree more with this option or this option? And I don't know, I should have taken a picture of it so I could have seen it. It's already going in the mail. But, you know, it's, so is it this option or this option? I'm like, well, I don't agree with any of those. It's this option. And I wrote my own option in and filled in the circles on my option. Because this is what they do, though. They don't teach people to think critically. They do not teach us to think critically. Critical thinking is despised. It's looked down upon. You can think critically within this frame of mind, within this box right here. But don't ever think outside of this box. I mean, that's dangerous right there. And by the way, that exists in churches too. Okay? That you can't think outside of that. You can't think differently than this. Well, you don't ever have to agree with me. I tell you that all the time. You don't ever have to agree with me. But make sure what you believe is backed up by the Bible. I try everything I believe and teach and preach, I try and back it up with the Bible. Because I want my faith to be brought out of that book, not me reading it into that book. And that means I've had to rethink some things that I was taught. And nothing against the men that taught me. I love them dearly. But look, men are men. They're fallible. So we just have to submit ourselves to this book, which we just spent, you know, the last 3 weeks, why this book is superior and why we are subject to this book. But people are taught not to think critically. Hey, the Bible teaches think critically. Brother Pooler kept bringing it up. His class is called the Berean class. Why? Because they were more noble than those in Thessalonica, and that they searched the scriptures daily to see if those things are so. They were searching to see if what Paul was saying was so. They were being critical thinkers. Is that really what the Bible teaches? Is this guy, he's talking about Jesus, is he really the Messiah? Is he really the Christ? That's what they were doing. And that's despised in academia. It's despised in theology, to think critically. Man, I don't mean this in the wrong way, but question everything. I don't mean that in the wrong way. I don't. I've always naturally been, I guess, inquisitive or a critical thinker. If I believe it, I'm looking for the weak link in it. We can go back to some of these. I'll tell you something that just came to my mind when we were over here. I don't remember which one we were at, so hopefully we find it. When I was studying through this, looking at it, it was this one right here. Volcanic rocks in Hawaii were dated at 160 million to 3 billion years old when they were actually formed from an eruption in 1801. All right, so we know it was formed in 1801, right? Okay, here's where my mind thinks when I came across that. I thought, yeah, but the lava could be 160 to 3 billion years old. Well, I know that's not true, but just my mind thought that instantly when I came across that. How do we know the lava's not that old, though, and it just formed into the rocks at that time? See, does that make sense to you? Think critically. I don't believe that, but that's what came into my mind, because if I was an evolutionist, that's what I'd slap in somebody's face. That's what I would tell to somebody like me. So I try and think like that and jump the gun on any questions or arguments that somebody's going to have to me. This is why it's good sometimes for us to listen to other viewpoints. Other points of view, you know, especially we could talk politics or even religion, whatever it may be, whatever topic it is. But I consider myself, probably most people would consider me like ultra super far right conservative. OK, I call myself a constitutionalist. OK, but look, it's good for me to look over here at the ultra liberal and the liberals and what they think, because they may have some arguments that I'm like, I never looked at it like that before. And you can learn from somebody like that. You can learn from somebody like that. I mean, let's not get all our teaching from them, but you can learn from that. And you can learn maybe the arguments they're going to use against you. I mean, I'd encourage you watch, you know, creation evolution debates. Why? So you can learn. What are the arguments they're going to use? What would somebody possibly say against me if I brought this up? How are they going to argue against it? That's just one example. When I was coming across that, that's where I was at. Think critically. That we're taught not to think critically. All right, we left off here. In general, dates in the correct ballpark are assumed to be correct and are published, but those different are just pushed to the side. If all the rejected dates were retrieved from the wastebasket and added to the published dates, the combined results would show that the dates produced are the scatter that one would expect by chance alone, because they're just all over the place. It just doesn't even make sense. They're just scattered everywhere, and it's just like just throwing the dice and be like, we'll pick that one, you know, and oh, that one's good. Oh, that one over there, because those are the dates that are given for this radiometric dating. Ian Taylor, an engineer. None of this is mentioned in popular magazines and textbooks, and the impression is left in the reader's mind that absolute chronology has been established by the radiocarbon method. And look, is that who grew up going to public school in here? Okay, is that what you got in your science class? That it's established and these are the dates and this is how old the earth is? Anybody else, or was it just me? I mean, that's what I got. Was there anybody else in here that got those are the established dates? Yeah. I mean, because that's what they teach you, like it's established fact, but it's constantly changing. It's constantly revolving. So that's how they teach it. That's how they put it forward, because they remove all the discrepancies. And they're like, well, we don't want to confuse them with facts that teach contrary to what we're trying to indoctrinate them with. So let's remove all those. That way it looks like science agrees with this. And then people grow up and they think, hey, you know, I stand with science. Science has proved evolution. And this is the science they're talking about. Number 5, most dating methods point to a young Earth. Walt Brown, PhD in mechanical engineering from MIT, lists 22 dating methods that point to a young Earth. So this isn't some guy like in his basement, okay? I mean, this is a professor from MIT, or a graduate from MIT. I don't know if he's a professor there, but he has a PhD, okay? I mean, he's studied. And he lists 22 dating methods that point to a young Earth. Here's his book, In the Beginning, Compelling Evidence for Creation and the Flood. Andrew Snelling, PhD in geology, lists several dating methods that point to a young Earth. Here's his book. I mean, these are books. Get them, read them. Earth's Catastrophic Past. I haven't read these. I'm just telling you. Geology, Creation, and the Flood. You get into some of these, there's going to be some kind of technical stuff. You're going to read through them, but, you know, it's good information. I'm not saying that. Here's something else they're going to teach. They're going to say that, oh, you know, established science has said these things and no real scientist believes in creation. That's what they try and put forward. It's propaganda to get you to believe that only, you know, dumb fundamentalists, you know, not a fundamentalist, but a fundamentalist, only they believe this type of stuff. No, that's not the case. The truth is the evidence agrees with us. And here you've got PhD scientists, doctors that are agreeing with this as well. So it's not just some nutcase. The following questions are by Mark Cadwallader. Who would like that name growing up? Anybody? No, that's a weird one right there. Anyway, all right. He's a chemical engineer. Here's what he proposes, okay? So why do the oldest trees happen to be just a few thousand years old? Why aren't they older? I guarantee they're not going to be older than 4,000 years old. Why? The flood. The oldest trees will not be older than that. All right. Why is there so little helium in the atmosphere if such a quickly diffusing gas is escaping from rocks at high rates? Good question there. Why are there radioactive halos preserved in granite rocks from elements with half-lives of only several minutes? So how could that happen if that's their half-life, if they're millions of years old? See, the fact is, these are, I forget what type of questions they are. Someone help me. Questions that already have the answer implied? Rhetorical questions. Thank you. All right, these are rhetorical questions that the answer is obvious, that it's not millions of years old. What they're teaching can't be true. So why do polystrate fossils pierce through so many different layers of supposed geologic time? Or that makes sense, right? You're like, what is that talking about? I had to look it up too, polystrate. What does that mean? It's like a tree going through the geologic column, okay, standing straight up through the geologic column. So why do those fossils pierce through so many different layers of supposed geologic time? If they were laid down over millions and millions of years, where did this tree come from? This petrified tree standing right up through what's supposed to be, you know, 100 million year difference or whatever it is. That doesn't make any sense. That should just do away with that false theory. But it doesn't. Why? Because this they're willingly ignorant of, so they can continue in their lusts. Why are carbon-14 dating measurements continually finding mere thousands of years for fossilized trees? That fits what the Bible says, I'll tell you that much. See, the evidence is all pointing to this book. That's where the evidence goes. Why is carbon-14 being found in some diamonds and coal in which all the radioactive carbon should be long gone because they're supposed to be millions of years old? I mean, who's heard that diamonds are millions of years old? So why is there carbon-14 in them? If by the end of their half-life, 100,000 years should be no traceable amounts of carbon-14. Why is there carbon-14 then in them? The obvious answer is they're not millions of years old. That's the obvious answer, but they're willingly ignorant. Why are many gas and oil reservoirs under such high pressure so that they become gushers and flow of their own accord when rock porosity, permeability, and cracks are all around to relieve pressure over the supposed millions of years? So how come they haven't just oozed out already? Because they've had all this time, according to evolution. Why is the Earth's magnetic field decaying so rapidly, extrapolating backwards to levels that would be destabilizing within approximately 10,000 years? So if we go backwards, it wouldn't even be stable 10,000 years. The evidence that's there doesn't fit with what they're teaching us. Why do we see so many comets in our solar system, since the comet tails are evidence of their volatile material boiling away as they pass by the sun? They should all have been consumed by now if the solar system is billions of years old. There shouldn't be any comets. They should just be long gone. Okay, critical thinking, what could you say to that? Right there. My first thing is, well, there's new comets. That's what I would say if someone brought that argument up to me. That's what I would say. Well, how do we know there's not new comets? I'm not a scientist, though. Why haven't the continents eroded nearly flat? I mean, think about it. When it rains, the water all comes down. I mean, and the dirt with it, erosion. So over, you know, billions of years, how come the continents haven't eroded flat if there's been that much time? And I used to live in Rio Rancho there, right off Southern and Unser. And I want to say it was like 2004, 2005. We were getting like a bunch of rain out there in the summer. And it would completely wash the roads away. I mean, the ditch, which was like maybe, you know, this wide in some spots where the road, where a road went into it and there was a ditch going by it and stuff. It would be like this wide where the water would rush over. It would end up being this wide and the road was gone. From just one rainstorm, it would wash away that much. And then they'd have for the next week, they'd have a bunch of tractors out there, front end loaders, moving all that dirt, putting it back, fixing the road. And that's just one storm. So why isn't the earth flat if we've been here millions of years? Why haven't the oceans accumulated sediment thousands of feet deep if the earth is really billions of years old? Because, hey, where does everything go? Where does all water go to? To the ocean. It's all going to the lowest point, right? We say sea level. I mean, you know, we're, what, almost a mile. We are a mile up here, 5,700 something. I don't know how high we are here exactly, but we're that many feet high, and all the water is going to run down. I mean, the Rio Grande goes into the Gulf of Mexico. I mean, that's where it ends up at. All this stuff goes into the ocean. So obviously, it's going to be running, bringing all that sediment. So why isn't the sediment in the oceans thousands of feet deep if the earth is really billions of years old? The observations cited in the questions above are all affirmative evidence for a young Earth. Evolutionists will always come up with stories to try to explain away the simple, direct implication of these observations. It's up to you, get this right here, it's up to you to discern between stories and evidence. See, as adults, it's easier for us to do that, and we can still be tripped up. Now think about a second, third, fourth, fifth grader that we teach, hey, obey your teacher. Listen to your teacher, they're going to teach you things. And we're telling them to listen to their teacher, but now we're, how are they going to discern between stories and evidence? Go to Hebrews chapter 6, please. All right, you at Hebrews 6. All right, now go to Hebrews 5:12. It's just like two, three verses up. For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, so you should be teaching, here's what's being said right here. Ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. So it's saying, like, you need to go back to a baby's diet. You should be teaching. You missed these first principles. I preached on those, but you need milk and not strong meat. You can't handle the strong meat. Get this, verse 13. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age. So they're fully mature. Even those, get this, who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. So discernment is something that doesn't naturally come to children. They have to learn that. You don't just naturally have discernment. I mean, some people can be gifted more than others in that area, but it's something you have to grow in. And discernment is the ability to tell between right and wrong, between true and false. And he's saying if you're a baby, if you're young, you're not going to get that. You have to be fully mature to get that discernment. We're sending our kids off to get indoctrinated with this stuff when we can barely see the difference, when we can barely pick out what's wrong with the false teachings that are being put out there. And we expect our kids to withstand all that. That's why we've got to teach them these things. We have to get it in their head. Get this type of information to them. Deprogram them. I mean, we've got to get it in there. Salvation will make the biggest difference. Man, but we've got to get this truth to them. Because even if they don't go to public school or whatever, it's all over our whole society. This teaching. Just watch some documentary on any type of animal and, you know, it always starts off, oh, well, billions of years ago, millions of years ago, you know, this is when it all started. I mean, it's there, it's everywhere around us. And it's believed by most people. Most people just accept it hook, line, and sinker. Why? Because they got brought up being taught the same nonsense and that the Bible doesn't have the answers and the Bible's not applicable to life today. And the Bible's some old book that you can't trust. That's what they've been taught. And sadly, preachers haven't been able to stand up and say, no, the Bible is truth. The Bible does apply. Here's how it applies. Here's how it fits today. And we haven't had answers for them. That's all they see. See, it doesn't have any answers. Sometimes our silence is deafening. So it's up to you to discern between stories and evidence. David Stone, PhD in physics. All right, let's stop right there.